After studying this module, you shall be able to understand the concept of BOP and its structure, understand the BOP equilibrium and disequilibrium, analyze the role of different theories of BOP to adjust its disequilibrium. Whatever the mode of international business, it involves cross-border movement of funds. The movement of funds is reflected in a country's balance of payment. In other words, balance of payment shows the financial impact of international business. It is from this point of view that it is essential to acquaint the readers with the basic concept of balance of payment and its structure. The present chapter also includes equilibrium, disequilibrium, and adjustment mechanism phenomena relating to BOP. Understand the concept of BOP and its structure. First, we start with concept of balance of payment. The concept of balance of payment is used in various ways and can have different connotations. Here we use the concept that had given by Machalap to define BOP in different ways. Machalap, 1950, had pointed out that the fundamentally different ideas are continually used by the same name, the balance of payments. Accordingly, balance of payment may be, first, an accounting balance, that is a balance of credit or debits, or second, a program balance, that is a balance of hopes and desires, or third, a market balance, that is a balance of supply and demand. We have first accounting balance. The accounting balance of payment of a country is a systematic record of all economic transactions between the residents of a country and the rest of the world during specified period. It is an ex post concept used on statistical information and estimates. It shows the character and dimensions of the country's international economic relationship, the country's trading position, changes in its net positions as foreign lender and borrower, changes in its official reserve holdings. Accounting balance, by virtue of its basic feature, has insufficient information for formulating and conducting the payments policy. The accounting balance is essentially classificatory and not analytical. It represents an ex post grouping of international transactions by type or by transact or. It only indicates the extent of balance or imbalance of past transaction. It cannot measure with any regularity or exactness the gaps that have to be filled. For this purpose, the authorities must know the extent of balance or imbalance of present and future transactions. Thus, the notion of balance or imbalance in international payments has to be an ex ante one, which is analytical rather than descriptive. The second is program balance. The program balance of payment is a statement of sources and uses of foreign funds expected or planned over a future period of one or more years. It is based upon the nation's investment and consumption requirements and on a program of meeting an excess of requirement over resources by foreign funds expected or sought. It is a forecast of the country's exchange needs and desires. Deficit and surpluses are defined in terms of gaps between the needs and desires on the one hand and the amount of foreign exchange expected to become available from all regular sources on the other hand. This concept is most useful to countries regularly dependent on foreign financing assistance to sustain certain level of home consumption and capital formation. It indicates the amount of funds that will be needed and for how long. At present, the use of this concept is confined to less developed countries that depend upon foreign assistance for development. As in all forecasting and programming, past experience plays a dominant role in the computation of a program balance of payment. The third, market balance. The market balance of payment is characterized by the effective demand and supply of foreign exchange at the given exchange rates. This is an ex ante concept with major emphasis on the effects which the changes in the exchange rates might have upon the amounts of exchange effectively demanded and supplied. Thus, it compares autonomous spending and receipts given present and expected future incomes, price and interest rates. Accordingly, the rate of exchange is the product of interaction of the demand and supply schedules. For financial authorities, the thing of the greatest importance is the extent of balance or imbalance of the country's autonomous intended transactions. For this purpose, the market balance provides a much more useful tool of analysis than does the accounting balance. The market balance gives an accurate index of current balance or imbalance in international payments. Thus, tentatively, balance of payment is said to be in balance when the demand for foreign exchange is just equal to the supply at the given exchange rate, that is, autonomous transactions requiring foreign money payments is just equal to autonomous transactions involving money receipts. Similarly, balance of payment is said to be in imbalance when demand and supply are not equal, that is, when the autonomous receipts and payments are not equal. Now we move on to structure of BOP. The transactions entering the balance of payment can be broadly divided into three categories: transaction in goods and services, transfer payments, and capital transactions. Both the transactions in goods and services and capital involve a quid pro quo. Transfer payments, on the other side, are payments from some persons or body of another country without a quid pro quo. Thus, they are usually called unrequired transfers or unilateral transfers. Balance of payment measures flows rather than stocks during a specified period. Balance of payment data records only the changes in assets, holding and liabilities. These do not represent the absolute levels of the items included in the balance sheet. Therefore, balance of payment of a country is the statement of sources and uses of funds. For a country, the sources of funds are acquisitions of external purchasing power, that is, the right of a country has to claim goods and services or to invest in another country. The balance of payment transactions, therefore, is showing acquisition of funds and uses of funds among countries. These transactions are divided vertically into credits and debits, accounting to the principles of double entry bookkeeping. Accordingly, the debits always equals the credits and the balance of payment accounts are always in balance. If debit or credit side is more than the credit or debit one, the resulted gap known as balance of payment deficit or surplus. Transactions are also divided horizontally into major categories, that is, current account and capital account. Now we are going to explain BOP equilibrium and disequilibrium. We start with BOP equilibrium. Since the balance of payment is constructed on the basis of double entry bookkeeping, credit is always equal to debit. If debit on the current account is greater than the credit side, funds flow into the country, which are recorded on the credit side of the capital account. The excess of debit is wiped out. Thus, the concept of balance of payment is based on the concept of accounting equilibrium, that is, current account plus capital account is equal to zero. The accounting balance is an ex post concept. It describes what has actually happened over a specific past period. There may be accounting disequilibrium when the two sides of the autonomous flows differ in size. But in such cases, accommodating flows bring the balance of payment back to equilibrium. Now we move on to BOP disequilibrium. In economic terms, balance of payment equilibrium occurs when surplus or deficit is eliminated from the balance of payment. However, normally in real life, such equilibrium is not found. Rather, it is disequilibrium in the balance of payment that is normal phenomena. In case of developing countries like India, China, etc., the tendency of disequilibrium always exists. Then we have types of disequilibrium. In the absence of long-term capital or with insufficient movements, disequilibrium can be classified broadly into those stemming from income, those from structural causes involving relative prices, and those which are a mixture of income and price. We start with income disequilibrium. Income disequilibrium is those in which income changes in relation to national income abroad or vice versa without significant changes in relative prices. Then we have structural changes. Structural changes are those which occur primarily in relative prices without necessarily significant changes in the level of national income. Then we have the third, the intermediate category. It includes the case of over and undervaluation of the exchange rate produced by changes in exchange rate or by domestic inflation. These are case of income and price. Then we have cyclical disequilibrium. Cyclical disequilibrium occurs either because the patterns or business cycles in different countries follow different paths or because income elasticity of demand for imports in different countries are different. Cyclical disequilibrium has been shown through the map presentation in the picture. In this figure, national money income is stable in B and fluctuates cyclically in A. Income elasticities of demand for imports may or may not be the same. The income elasticity of demand for import in B is not involved since income is stable. In this situation, A's imports and B's exports will decline in depression and rise in prosperity. B's imports and A's exports will continue steady. The result is that A will have an export surplus in depression and an import surplus in prosperity. And B will have a deficit when A is depressed and a surplus when A is prosperous. If the national income of A and B both follow the cyclical path of A and income elasticities of import in both countries are unity and hence identical, there will be no disequilibrium. Then we have secular disequilibrium. Under secular stagnation, investment opportunities are inadequate to absorb full employment savings. In periods of secular acceleration on the country, investment is too high relative to the savings of the economy. The cause of the imbalance in the Keynesian system, of course, is that the forces lying behind savings and investment are different and both are relatively inelastic with respect to rate of interest. Savings are a function of income to some degree of wealth and of institutional forces such as the practices in life insurance and mortgage amortization. Investment, on the other hand, is responsive to innovation, population change, availability of management, and so on. In particular, countries may tend to have many investment opportunities relative to saving in the early stages of growth and the opposite at a later stage. Then we have structural disequilibrium. Structural disequilibrium may be caused by a non-systematic change in taste or in technology or in anything which alters the price of an export upward or downward. An increase in the foreign demand for a country's output is structural disequilibrium of a sort, but one which it is not difficult to deal. The remedy is an increase in output of the product, an increase in consumption and imports by the country. The cause of the disturbance may be change in supply. The classical illustration is crop failure, which cut off the supply of a country's exports and produced a shortfall of exports below imports. A bumper crop abroad which lowered world prices would have much the same effect. Others are exhaustion of the soil of mines. Then we have random disequilibrium. Random disequilibrium is not a permanent cause or specific cause of disequilibrium. This kind of disequilibrium exists because of adjustment process. Now we are going to analyze the role of different approaches of BOP to adjust its disequilibrium. The first is elasticity approach. The traditional approach in respect of effects of devaluation is considered in the form of Marshall-Lerner condition. It means exports earning will increase and imports expenditure will decline if price elasticity is more than proportionate, that is, if it exceeds unity or greater than unity. This situation is known as Marshall and Lerner condition since it was discovered in 1923 by A. Marshall and later in 1944 by Abba P. Lerner. The essence of this condition is that an improvement in competitiveness, that is relative prices, will improve trade balance and balance of payment only if the sum of price elasticity of demand for imports by resident and the price elasticity of demand for exports by non-resident is more than proportionate, exceeds or is greater than unity. The important point to note is that the emphasis of Marshall-Lerner condition is on the sum of the elasticity and not on elasticity separately. For this reason, the theory is called elasticity theory. This may also be called the theory of price effects on balance of payment. In case of deficit current account balance, they recommended for devaluation of currency. If currency is devalued, export becomes cheaper and import becomes costlier. Thus, export increases and import decreases, which automatically lead balance of payment back in equilibrium. But there is a condition that price elasticity must be greater than unity, that is, price elasticity is greater than 1, as shown in the equation, where EM is the price elasticity of demand for import and EX is the price elasticity of demand for export. The purpose of the elasticities theory is to bring out the effects of price changes on balance of payment. The theory provides the basis for a policy measure like devaluation of a currency, as it indicates the condition required for the success of devaluation as a measure to correct adverse balance of payment position. J curve effect. If the elasticity of demand is greater than unity, the import bill will contract and export earnings will increase as a sequel to devaluation. Trade deficit will be removed. However, the problem is that the trade pattern may also devalue its own currency as a retaliatory measure. Moreover, there may be a long lapse of time before the quantities adjust sufficiently to change in price. Till then, trade balance will be even worse than that before devaluation. This is nothing but the J-curve effect of devaluation. J-curve effect of devaluation has been shown through the graph in the picture. In this figure, trade balance moves deeper into the deficit zone immediately after devaluation, but then it gradually improves and crosses into surplus zone. The curve resembles the alphabet J, and so it is known as the J-curve effect. On the basis of experiences of India, trade deficit was very high in 1965, and then India devalued rupee by 36% in June 1965. Exports should have gone up, but export increased only in 1972. Between 1966 to 71, devaluation does not help exports to rise. So this theory was examined by many experts, and they realized that there is a lag between devaluation and rising exports. Apart from this, the theory also suffers with some major limitations. First, it assumes that country's balance of payment position is in balance initially, and that change in prices would affect the balance of payment. This is not correct, as no country's balance of payment is in balance, that is neither surplus nor deficit. Secondly, generally, export and imports consist of thousands of different items, and it is difficult to estimate elasticities for all these individually or in aggregate. The third, Marshall-Lerner conditions assume that the supply side is highly flexible. That is, there are no difficulties in the availability of goods for export, and production will quickly respond to changes in foreign demand. This is not correct. The most important of these other influences is the change in income. Lastly, the elasticity theory overemphasizes the role of trade in improving a country's balance of payment. Changes take place in other parts of balance of payment as well, that is, in the current account as a whole as well as in the capital account. Now we move on to absorption approach. This approach is developed in the year 1952 by S.S. Alexander of the International Monetary Fund. It is based on Keynes' theory of balance of payment, which explains balance of payment on current account as a macroeconomic phenomena. It focuses attention on the relationship between international trade and the domestic economy, or the domestic economic activity represented by national income or gross national product, that is GNP. Thus, unlike the elasticity approach, which attempts to explain what happens to the balance of payment when relative price change, the absorption approach explains the changes in national income and their impact on balance of payment. National income or national output is the sum total of economic activity of a country during a year, that is, a sum total of goods and services produced in a year. This may be measured as income earned by its population, or as output produced by the economy, or as expenditure or total spending in the economy. For the purpose of absorption, what is relevant is the latter two, that is, output and spending or expenditure. Total availability or aggregate supply of goods or services in the economy is represented by output. What is produced is also used for consumption and investment in the economy. This is total spending. The relationship between income or output and expenditure or spending may be expressed thus, as income is equal to consumption plus investment, where Y stands for income or output and C and I stands for consumption and investment spending respectively. In a closed economy, that is an economy which has no transaction with the rest of the world, all national income or output will flow between producers and consumers within the economy. As a result, there will be no tendency for national income or output to change unless consumers on their own change their production levels. Thus, Keynes' theory of income predicts that when there is change in level of either consumption or saving or investment, national income or output will increase or decline. In an open economy, however, foreign trade influences national income or national output through changes in exports and imports. An increase in export earnings is in addition to or injection into national income stream, and spending on imports is a subtraction or leakage from the income stream. The increase in exports increases national income, and increase in imports causes decline of it. This relationship between national income or output and foreign trade may be expressed through an equation where income, that is Y, is equal to C plus I plus X minus M. Here, C plus I represent consumption and investment spending. X minus M represent trade balance. X stands for exports and M stands for imports. The question is, by how much will the national income increase due to an increase in exports? This is measured by the ratio of increase in national income to increase in export earnings. This ratio is called foreign trade multiplier. Similarly, national income will decline due to spending on imports is measured by the ratio of increase in imports to increase in income. This is called marginal propensity to imports. The net effect of the operation of these two tendencies determine the impact of foreign trade on national income. The conclusion that follow are, if in a year expenditure or spending in the economy, it means that the economy is absorbing or using up more resources than are available in the economy. The difference is available in the form of imported resources, and this is reflected in the balance of payment deficit. If on the other side, output exceeds expenditure in the economy, it means that the economy has more resources to spare in the form of exports, and this is reflected in the balance of payment surplus. The basic relationship for the absorption approach is BOP is equal to Y minus E, where BOP is balance of payment, Y is income or output, and E is expenditure. According to absorption, balance of payment deficit or surplus on current account reflects the difference between national output and national expenditure. Now we move on to monetary approach. The monetary approach to balance of payment or external transactions emphasize the role played by money supply in a country's balance of payment. This is because money supply is the basis for total or aggregate demand in the economy. Every transaction in the economy is financed by the use of money. According to this approach, balance of payment surplus or deficit is a monetary phenomena because it results from excess demand for money or excess supply of money in the economy. If there is excess money supply, it may be spent within the country and abroad, and the country will run into balance of payment deficit, leading to an outflow of the national currency. If there is an inflow of currency into the country, it means that the country is receiving more money than it is paying abroad. That is, there is balance of payment surplus. In short, inflows and outflows of currency in an economy are associated with balance of payment surplus and deficit. Since money supply changes take place not only due to transaction in goods and services, but also because of capital transactions between countries. The monetary approach explains the balance of payment situation as a whole, including capital account. The important features of this theory are that it establishes a relationship between money supply and balance of payment. The policy implications of this theory are twofold. First, is that for a proper understanding of the balance of payment situation of a country, it is necessary to analyze the demand and supply of money in an economy. The second implication is that any balance of payment policy must aim to bringing into balance the demand for money and the supply of money by focusing attention on the control of domestic money supply. Mundell in the year 1968 also incorporates interest rate and capital account in the ambit of discussion. In his view, it is not only government spending but also interest rates that influences income as well as balance of payment. While larger government spending increases income, an increase in income leads to rise in import. With a positive marginal propensity to import, any rise in income as a sequel to increase in government spending will lead to greater imports and worsen the current account. However, changes in the interest rate influence both the capital account and current account. A higher interest rate will lead to improvement in current account through lowering of income. At the same time, a higher interest rate will improve the capital account by attracting foreign investment flow. Then we have New Cambridge School approach. It takes into account savings, that is S, investment, that is I, taxes, that is T, and government spending, that is G, and their impact on the trade account. In form of equation, it can be written as S plus T plus M is equal to G plus X plus I. This theory assumes that S minus I and T minus G are determined independently of each other and of the trade gap. S minus I is normally fixed as the private sector has a fixed net level of saving. So, the balance of payment deficit or surplus is dependent upon T minus G and constant S minus I. In other words, with constant S minus I, it is only the manipulations of T minus G that is necessary and a sufficient tool for balance of payment adjustment. Now we move on to the summary. It starts with first, international business involves cross-border movement of funds. The movement of funds is reflected in a country's balance of payment. Secondly, balance of payment shows the financial impact of international business. Third, Mashalap in the year 1950 had pointed out that fundamentally different ideas are continually used by the same name, the balance of payment. Fourthly, the accounting balance of payment of a country is a systematic record of all economic transactions between the residents of a country and the rest of the world during specified period. It shows the character and dimensions of the country's international economic relationship, the country's trading position, changes in its net position as foreign lender and borrower, changes in its official reserve holding, etc. Fourthly, accounting balance by virtue of its basic feature has insufficient information for formulating and conducting the payments policy. The accounting balance is essentially classificatory and not analytical. It represents an ex post grouping of international transaction by the type or by transact or. It only indicates the extent of balance or imbalance of past transaction. Fifth, the program balance of payment is a statement of sources and uses of foreign funds expected or planned over a future period of one or more years. It is based upon the nation's investment and consumption requirement and on a program of meeting an excess of requirement over resources by foreign funds expected or sought. Sixth, the market balance of payment is characterized by the effective demand and supply of foreign exchange at the given exchange rates. This is an ex ante concept with major emphasis on the effects which the changes in the exchange rate might have been upon the amounts of exchange effectively demanded and supplied. Seventh, the structure of BOP transaction can be broadly divided into three categories, namely transaction in goods and services, transfer payments, and capital transactions. Eighth, BOP equilibrium exists because it is based on the double entry accounting system. Credit is always equal to debit. Ninth, BOP disequilibrium is an economic concept which ex ante. According to this, there is always either surplus or deficit in a country's balance of payment. Then next we have, there are four types of equilibrium. It consists of cyclical, structural, secular, random, disequilibrium. Next, there are three approaches to adjust the BOP disequilibrium. Then next we have elasticity approach considers the role of price effect on the BOP. Then next, the absorption approach considers the role of income effect on the BOP. And finally, the monetary approach considers the role of money supply on the BOP.